Yes, now the recording has been started. I feel today there is only 42 students in the class. Feel all the students will get started because it's already 10:05 now. We have been waiting in since 5 6 minutes. Okay, so instead of waiting for more time, I would like to just start with the today's session, because today up to yesterday we have seen the prerequisite of the subject, as well as we have completed with the introduction of the COA. We have seen why we are learning the COA and likewise. Okay, so now we will start with the actual subject today. Okay, we will start with the actual subject where we will be learning the evolution of the computers. So last time I have shown you the video for the evolution of the computers. Yes or no? Whether you people have attended that evolution of computers? Some video, the 3 minutes, 4 minutes video I had
Yes.
played. Yes. Okay. So I have already shown you that video. Now, just whatever we have seen inside the video, the same things are there in our PPTs. So we are only learning about the first generation computers, second generation computers, and likewise we will study, and then we will see what are the differences between the present generation and previous generation. Okay, so I'm going to share the PPTs with you. So I hope this PPT is visible to you. Is this PPT visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Thank you. So let's start with the actual learning from here. History of the computers. Now we will be starting with the first generation of the computers, where this first generation of computers were the vacuum tubes. Okay. Now, here I wanted to know you that what are these vacuum tubes are. Okay, what are these vacuum tubes, or why it is there? Okay, in our previous TVs also, if you have seen the televisions before 25 years, before 30 years, at that time those televisions are made up of the vacuum tubes. Okay, so what are those vacuum tubes? These are the tubes in which some liquid is flowing inside. Okay, that liquid is going from one place to another place, and due to viscosity of that liquid, we can able to see the things on the screen. Okay, so these are the what I can say. On those days, the monitors were so much large, so much used, where on the back side of it there were some vacuum tubes are there. Okay, so it was looking so huge. Okay, have you seen that TV screens previously, the old wale televisions?
Yes.
Okay, so that was the same technique which has been used in the computers also. That was first designed by ENIAC. So this ENIAC word we have already learned in the video also. So ENIAC is nothing but the electronic numerical integrator and the computer. So that was the ENIAC. It has been designed in 1943, and it was completed designing in 46, and it was constructed in the University of Pennsylvania, and John Eckert and John Macaulay was the what I can say, the founder of this ENIAC first generation computers. Okay, so this is as this is the first generation computers, these are only developed for electronic kind of digital computers. Okay, where these are designed in the BRL laboratory. BRL is still the very famous laboratories where such kind of researches are going on, and these laboratories are actually commonly used for the research purposes. Okay, the way to supply the trajectory tables for the new weapons accurately, okay, and within reasonable time frame is the what I can say is the intention of this BRL laboratory. Okay, so where these trajectory tables are used, okay, Trajectory tables means what? If you have designed any gun, okay, I'm just giving you one example for it. If you want to design any game, gun, then at that time that gun must shoot with the proper directions and with the proper trajectories. So these trajectories and these permutation combination of these trajectories has been designed with this Army's Ballistics Research Laboratory, and because of that it has been used. Okay, Army, that is why this name has been used, Army's Ballistics Research Laboratory. Still, this BRL laboratory is used for designing of the new weapons, having the proper trajectory tables. Okay, and it was not finished in time to be used in the war effort. Okay, so still in 1946, it was not in a position to finish that particular trajectory tables with the new weapons for the war. Okay. It's the first task, that means the first task was to perform a series of calculations that were used to help determine the feasibility of the hydrogen bomb. So if you see this kind of what I can say, the applications of this, just give me 1 minute, just give me 1 minute. Hello. Yes. Sorry, some disturbances at my side. So I have just closed it. So here, if you see these applications over here, okay, if you see these applications, all these applications are related with the army, okay, where everything is related with the hydrogen bomb, design of the new weapons, and likewise. So this BRL management, okay, this BRL management continued from 1946 to 1955 for the designing of this particular weapons. And for all these designing kind, they required this vacuum tube kind of the first generation ENIAC computers. Now guys, there are no much questions on this, or maybe only MCQ type of questions will arise for such kind of theory which we are learning just now. But if you see the actual applications of this BRL laboratory, or if you search sometime, if you got time, just search sometime, browse for the BRL laboratory, you will find there were so many innovative kind of things which they have ejected with. So this BRL laboratory is doing an extraordinary things with respect to the security of our nation. Okay. This John von Neumann. Now this name is very famous. Okay, John von Neumann. I may say that this is the name of that scientist who has invented the first ENIAC kind of computers. After ENIAC, they have been pronouncing it as the EDVAC. Okay, they have been pronouncing it as a EDVAC. This is the EDVAC. Okay, electronic discrete variable computer. Up till now, the previous ENIAC computer was only able to do some kind of digital operations, which were related with some trajectories and designing of the new weapons and likewise. But this is the first discrete kind of computer which has been used for the general purpose human being, and it was since 1945. Okay. Previously, ENIAC don't have any kind of storage capacity, but this von Neumann EDVAC is having some kind of storage concept. Okay, so this von Neumann is the mathematician who has designed this EDVAC. Okay, and he's having a suitable form of storing capacity. Okay, he's having a suitable form of storing capacity where he can only able to store, let us say, 1K, only 1 KB. Okay, likewise, but from that moment onwards, that is from 1945 onwards up to 1952, okay, up to 1952, he was only in the position to store a single K unit of the memory. So you might be aware there are memory storage where 1 KB we can store. Okay, after KB there is GB. Okay, after GB there is TB. Okay, can anybody tell me what is this GB and TB? You might be aware, but let me just confirm it out. Anybody?
गीगाबाइट टेराबाइट
Yes.
गीगाबाइट टेराबाइट
Yes, very correct. Kilobyte, gigabyte, and terabytes. So these are the form of the storage where we can able to store the units of the memory. Okay. So this IS computer is nothing but developed by the Princeton University Institute for the Advanced Studies, and these are the first. These are the these EDVAC are the first general purpose computers. Okay. Up till now, no general purpose computer has been invented. So this is the first general purpose computer, and this first computer, EDVAC, was completed in 1952. Okay. Now we will move ahead. Oh. Okay. So this is the first architectural structure of von Neumann machine. Okay, please see this. This is the first kind of architecture which has been designed. Guys, see, this architecture is very important because there was always a question on this IS computer. So you can mark this as important. Okay, where is my cursor? Okay, you can mark this as important. Okay, please excuse me with my handwriting because this is the pointer. Sometimes it works well, sometimes it doesn't behave well. So, but still, you just mark it as a star. Okay, you just mark it as a star. Okay, the structure of von Neumann machine. The structure of von Neumann machine consists of the main memory. Okay, and then IO input output unit. So this is the some kind of input I'm getting giving, and this is where I'm getting some output. In between, this is the box where the processing happens. Okay, this is the box of CPU. This is the box of CPU. Everyone knows that this is the CPU. So input given from the main memory and output comes from the input output devices. So here inside this CPU, we will be having this arithmetic logic unit. Hello, excuse me. Hello. Have got some voice of okay, anybody smiling? Hello. I've got some voice. Hello? Anybody wanted to say something? Guys? I hope all of you are listening. All of you are in a listening mode, and I'm go going good. Okay? That's my something assumption which I am taking ahead. Okay, if you have any difficulties, okay, please let me know. I'm here to solve your difficulties, and this is the first lecture, so everyone is in a fresh mood. So let us continue. Okay, please take care that your voice is muted so that others will not get disturbed. Okay, and even whatever I wanted to tell, there is many more things going on inside my mind whenever I'm delivering something. So whenever you are unmuting yourself, so it is creating a unnecessary nuisance. If you wanted to ask me something, then definitely you can unmute yourself and you can disturb. But in the other cases, please, you are requested to mute yourselves. Okay. So yes, we were at the CPUs. So this CPU is having the arithmetic logic unit. Okay, this arithmetic logic unit is performing all kind of arithmetic operations like addition, subtraction, then multiplication, and there are different algorithms that we are going to study in the unit number 2 also. Because whenever you will be designing a computer, so you required a mathematics over there. Without mathematics, no machine can be get designed. Okay, so for every machine we required the arithmetic logic unit. And this program control unit is nothing but the unit where which will be having the control on the data as well as on the instruction which will be sent through the different links. Okay, so these are the links which will be active when this is the, let us say, this is input link. If you see, the arrow is going on this direction here, whereas in here the arrow is going on this direction. These are the, what I can say, these are bi-directional. Okay, these are bi-directional arrows. Bi, this is the bi-directional arrows everywhere. Here also, here also, here also, and here also. These are the bi-directional arrows. Whereas, without which, if I'm sending some of the requests from the main memory to this arithmetic logic unit, it will be get processed over here, and then again output will be sent to the main memory. That means after processing to the each and every unit, the same thing will be processed here and here also. Okay, so without these two, okay, without these two, the CPU will not be active. So whatever is processing is required inside this IS computer, which will be done by this CPU. And this is the structure of von Neumann machine. This is very important as well as it's very simple to understand. Okay, yes. Now this, whatever we have seen, it's the overall structure. Just now whatever we have seen is the overall structure. But if you see this structure of IS computer, this is something called as the what I can say, the internal structure of the CPU. Okay, so here this is the internal structure of arithmetic logic unit. This is the internal structure of arithmetic logic unit, and this is the internal structure of program control unit. Okay, this is the arithmetic logic unit. Okay, this is the arithmetic logic unit, which you can see here. Okay, which you can see here, this is arithmetic logic unit, and this is the program control unit. Now we will be looking for the details of it. Okay, so this is the detail, expanded structure of IS computer. Okay. Okay. Hey guys. Okay. Now this arithmetic logic unit consists of the components. These are the components we will see one by one. Okay, this AC. Okay, this is the first what I can say, first component of this arithmetic logic unit. AC. AC is nothing but the accumulator. Okay, AC is nothing but the accumulator. Now this is the structure which is very, very, very important. You just mark three stars over here. Okay, mark three stars. These are the three stars. Now what this accumulator does, guys, do you have pen and book at your side?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so whatever I'm just telling you, the long form. Okay, at least do write the long forms over there. Okay, AC is belonging to the arithmetic logic unit, where AC stands for the accumulator. Okay, so what this AC does? AC here, see this AC and MQ. See here, AC and MQ, accumulator and multiplier quotient. Now this where quotient will be get generated when you do the multiplication or wherever you do any kind of divisions, then quotient will be get generated. What these two does, AC and MQ? It is employed to temporarily hold operands. Okay, it will temporarily hold the operands. Now what are the operands? Operands, do you know? Okay, for example, 3 plus 4 is equal to 7. Okay, so this is the sign which has been involved. Okay, this is called as operator. This is called as operator, where this 3 and 4 is called as operands. Okay, these are called as the operands. For example, if some quotient will be get generated, okay, for example, instead of 3 plus 4, I am taking it as 5 plus 5. Okay, so 5 plus 5 is 10, so here answer is 0, and maybe some quotient will be get generated 10. If it is, let us say I'm taking another example, 12 plus 3. Okay, so 12 plus 3 is 15. Okay, but if it is 12 into 3, then what's the answer? Okay, so I just wanted to tell you, if some quotient will be get generated, okay, that too will be stored in this MQ. Okay, this is multiplier quotient that will be get generated while multiplication. This multiplier quotient or this AC accumulator is designed to hold the temporary operands. Okay, temporarily these operands will be hold. This arithmetic logic unit, what it will do, it will take these operands from this accumulator, okay, do the additions. If quotient will be get generated over here, that quotient will be get saved into MQ. Okay, and whatever result will be get generated, for example, this 15, so this 15 will be get stored into this MBR. MBR is nothing but the memory buffer register. Okay, see this is the memory buffer register. What this MBR does, it contains a word to be stored in the memory and sent to the input output unit. Okay, whatever output will be get generated, it will store it into the main memory and then send to the input output unit. Or it is also used to receive a word from a memory and from the input output device. So if you see this, okay, once the answer will be get stored into this main memory, same answer will be get propagated to this input output device. Or what it will do, it will also receive the input and get it stored into the main memory. That means here MBR will store the output to the input output device, or from input output device it take the output and save into the MBR. So it is the two-way directional things. Even the same answer, instead of input output device, the same answer it will going to store into the main memory. Okay, this MBR is a temporary memory. So if I wanted to save this answer to the main memory, then I have to save this answer to the main memory, and it can save it to the main memory, in the same way it can receive that particular answer to the main memory register. Now here I have taken only one simple example, 12 into 3. Okay, but there are multiple multiplications, like let us say 2, 3, 1, 8, 7, 5, 1, 2, 3, multiplied by 5, 1, 0, 2, 8. Okay, so what if this multiplication is there? Okay, so in that case, the multiple times, okay, the quotient will be get saved multiple times, accumulator contents will be get changed multiple times, arithmetic logic unit will be in a processing. Okay, and multiple times the data from MBR will be get changed. So at that time he has to take the help of the main memory, where some answers will be get stored into the main memory, again retrieve, again store, again retrieve, and finally the answer will be get stored. If you see this link, okay, finally the answer will be come over here. Okay, now after completion of this arithmetic operation, the data will flow to the program control unit. This program control unit will take this IBR as the first state. IBR is nothing but the instruction buffer register. This is the IBR, instruction buffer register. What it will do? It will temporarily hold the right hand instruction from the main memory. Okay, so whatever is instructions are there, for example, 5 into multiplied by this, 8 into multiplied by this, 2 into multiplied by this. So 5 times he has to do the multiplication, then again 5 times he has to do the addition, and then final answer, some final answer will be get extracted here. So these addition, these multiplications are the instructions which are followed by this particular operation, arithmetic operation. So that instructions will be stored over here in the IBR, and that will be get stored into the instruction register. So this instruction register IR is actually contains a 8-bit opcode instruction being executed. So opcode will be there. For example, what is the meaning of opcode? For example, if I am now dealing with the addition, so there is one instruction called as add. Okay, add, and there are registers are included. So there are A, B, B, then C and D. Okay, every A, B, C, D. So A is having two parts. Okay, actually this instruction, these registers A, B are 16-bit registers. Okay, but it has been divided into two 8-bit registers. So A low and A high. Okay, so this A low is having 8-bit of opcode and A high is having 8-bit of instruction opcode. Okay, so let us say that I'm using this A register and let us say that B register. So I'm writing here that A high, okay, and B high. Okay, so let us say that A high and B high is containing 8 into 3. So this add opcode is having, this add instruction is having, let us say, opcode as 08 or 8A. Okay, 8A is the opcode. So this IR register will understand 8A. Okay, it will not understand this add. Okay, that means yesterday in previous lecture I have given you an example that if I am telling Alexa, Alexa play a happy song for me. Okay, so Alexa will understand it and it will play it because it will, it can able to interpret the instructions. But my computer, if I'm saying my laptop that please open the Microsoft Word for me, it will not going to understand because it can only able to understand whatever the engine understands. For example, if I'm writing something to the C editor program, then C engine will understand whatever the requirements which I'm giving specifically. So object file is containing all kinds of opcode which has been designed for the multiple instructions. So in the same way here, this IS computer understands the assembly language. So every assembly language consists of the opcode. So for addition, 8A is the opcode. Let us say for subtraction, SUB, 8B might be the opcode. So this computer only understands the opcode language. It doesn't understand add, subtract, delete likewise. Okay, so this opcode will be given as input to this IR. Okay, and who extracted the opcode? This instruction buffer register. And whatever the opcode has been given input to the IR from this MAR. MAR is nothing but the memory address register. This address register, okay, this address register contains the address of this 08A. Means it consists of the address of add instruction. Okay, for example, मी जर एखादा program लिहिलाय, for example, if I have written some program in C language, so it will start, let us say my starting address of that instruction is 100, and if I am writing this statement addition at 104, that means starting address of that addition instruction is 104. So this MAR will store 104 address, and that address will be given to the instruction register. And this program counter is nothing but the counter which will just go ahead and ahead and ahead. It will take your addresses ahead. Okay, and then accordingly the control signals will be get generated. Okay, right now I will not go into the much detail of it, because how the control signals will be get generated, how these control signals will be get generated, for this purpose I am going to share one video with you. First of all, you will go with the video, and then we will see this control signal generation complete things in the next lecture. Because right now, today we have completed the so much of structure over here, this might get confusion to you. So because of that, I'm not going to take the details of the control circuits right now. Okay, so guys, please tell me if you have any problem into this structure of IS up till now, whatever we have completed.
Hello ma'am.
Yes
ma'am, can you explain MAR again?
Yes. Okay, so what this MAR is? MAR is nothing but the memory address register. Okay, memory address. Yes.
Screen share ka, screen clean karana ma'am.
Okay. Okay, ठीक है. Now see, we are at the MAR, memory address register. Now what this address register does? Okay, for example, I have started one program from line number 100. Okay, and here the start instruction I am going to execute. Okay, here somewhere start instruction is there. Then I have written some lines of code over here. And I'm talking about the add instruction. So let us say that this add instruction is at 108 line number. Okay, then after that again some instructions are there, and here I am ending my program, and I'm ending up my program at, let us say, 120. Okay, 120. This whole program from 100 to 120, this whole program has been saved into the main memory. First of all, okay, first of all it will save into the main memory. Now when instruction register will get the instructions that I have to perform, now let us say add instruction, then this instruction register will concert, it will concert to MAR, memory address register. That what it will concert, it will send an instruction, instruction register will send an instruction to the MAR that please extract the address of add. Okay, this what it will do, it will consult to the main memory, and it will get the address of, from main memory it will get the address of addition instruction. So what it will get, it will get 108. This 108 will be saved into instruction register. Okay, and MAR, the main function of MAR is only to get the addresses and nothing else. And whatever is current instruction address is extracted, that address will be only going to get saved into the instruction register. And that is the only functionality of MAR, to save the temporary address of the current instruction. When 108 will be get processed, it will shift to 109. Okay, and to get on from 108 to 109, it will take the help of the this particular program counter. Okay, it will take the help of this program counter. So program counter will increase the counter by 1, and from 108 it will shift to 109. When again 109 instruction address will be get retrieved from main memory and save into the instruction register, again it will go on shift to the 1010. So this program counter will be every time will be increased by 1 and 1 and 1, and every instruction will be get saved. So program counter will start at 100 and end at 120. end at 120, and that is the total functionality of MAR and program counter. Okay, the functionality of instruction register and IBR is to get the instruction, get whatever current instruction is there, that current instruction address will be saved instruction into instruction buffer register. Then again, that current address will be current instruction will be sent to instruction register, that this is the current instruction, get the address of it. Then instruction register will contact to MAR, get the current address, it will be get sent, and then that will be get sent to the control circuits. Control circuits will be having too much kind of functionality, so that functionality will start from 0 and up to 7 it will work. But that how that signals will be get operated, that I will tell you in the next lecture, because that is again one of the different logic that we are going to study in the next lecture. So if I take that one also, so it will little bit overburdened to understand the things. Guys, this structure of IS, expanded structure of IS computer, is very very important. In every time's question paper, this was the question for minimum 6 marks. So you just mark it on. It's very simple. You just need to understand what are these functionalities of memory buffer registers. These address registers are very important. These registers are very important. Now we have seen what are these registers are. Okay. Yes. Now any problem in this?
No.
No, ma'am.
Okay. Now see, today after this, I'm going to share that video with you. Okay. Everyone is requested to go through that video, because tomorrow we will be having a lecture of 11:15. So in that lecture, I'm going to start with that logic building of this, how the control circuits work. Okay. So if you go through that video, then it will be a little bit easier for me to explain it. Because it's what I can say, it's little bit a complicated circuit, and whatever we are learning right now is what I can say the background processing involved whenever you perform any kind of program. Okay, so I hope everyone has understood the concept. Please reply in the chat box if you have any problem with respect to today's what I can say lecture.
No, ma'am.
Okay, but let others also. Okay. I hope I'm enough loud, enough clear to make you understand the concept of IS, expanded structure of IS architecture. Okay. I will be just sharing within a minute that link where you need to go for it. Okay, just give me a minute. I will share that link with you. Later on, you are requested to go for that video. I think I will share it on the WhatsApp. Okay. It's not possible it for right now for me, because I'm not getting that link. So if you don't have any problem in that, so we will go further. Okay, we'll take one or two slides more and then we will stop. Okay. So these registers are clear. Okay. Now the next generation computers called as the commercial computers. Okay, called as the commercial computers. So these are the UNIVAC computers. Okay, the first one is ENIAC. Second, in ENIAC we will be using the vacuum tubes. Then EDVAC computers are there. And now EDVAC computer, that first ENIAC computers are for army BRL labs. Okay. Second one is we have seen the EDVAC computers. These are the first general purpose computers, and this is third UNIVAC, which is the commercial computers. These are the commercial computers. So these commercial computers has been invented in 1947. Okay, and these was the first commercial computers which are formed by Eckert and Macleay. These Eckert and Macleay were also involved in ENIAC also. Okay, so this is the UNIVAC 1, Universal Automatic Computer. Okay, this is the first successful computer. Okay, then it was intended for both scientific and commercial applications, and it was commissioned by the US Bureau in 1950. This is the first computer which was commissioned by the US Bureau of Census. Okay, this first Eckert and Macleay was also the part of UNIVAC division of Sperry R and Corporation. Okay, this is just for your information, and this is UNIAC 1, but in the same time UNIAC 2 was also delivered in late 1950s. Okay, and it has the great memory capacity and higher performance and backward compatible. That means we can do the backward operations over here, and that is the what I can say the advantages of the this first advantage of the commercial computers. Okay, then comes into the picture the IBM. Okay, IBM is since 1950 onwards, this IBM will come into the picture. He was the major manufacturer of punch card processing equipment. They were the first computer who has invented with the punch card system. That has been delivered its first electronic stored program computer in 1953. Okay. And it was mainly designed for the scientific kind of applications. That was first in 701, later in 702 product in 1955, some hardware features has been added. Okay, and this after that this series of 700 to 7000, okay, this series of 700 to 7000 computers has been established by this IBM. Every now and then they have been added something new and new version will be get released. So if you see in 1953, the first version was released, that is called as 702. Immediately after 2 years in 1955, second version of 702 has been released. So in the same way, 701, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, likewise up to 7000, the IBM was inventing something new, and they had got the overwhelming response for their computer manufacturer, and they are from that time onwards IBM is the first overwhelming dominant computer manufacturing company. Okay, up till now we have been only completed the first generation of computers. Okay, so I think we will stop here now, because second generation computers is something different now. We will be learning that second generation computers in the tomorrow's lecture at 11:15, and also we will be completing the expanded architecture what I am trying to give you. Okay, so yes, that's the end from my side for today. Guys, any problem in it? Have you understood each and everything which I wanted to convey? I hope you are understanding each and everything. Do you? Okay. Thanks guys for replying. Now all of you are requested to put your attendance in the chat box. Okay, your name and your number. What is the class strength? What is the class strength? Anybody knows what is the flash film?
73 something.
Okay. But still, the 100% class is not attending. Daily 59-60 students were there only.
69 is 10.
69. Still, 7 to 10 people are not attending. I need to consult. Sherke sir is your class teacher, no?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Okay. I hope you have marked your attendance. If you have marked your attendance, then you can leave. Thank you. Okay, if everybody has marked, then I can leave the meeting. I just want your roll number. What is this 21910380? I don't want PRN. Just add your roll number. Soham, Jadhav, are you there?